Thank you. And thanks to everyone for joining. Big shout out to the folks that put this all together, AFCEC and sustainability in Illinois. It's such a great opportunity to connect with everyone until we can all be together again soon. So to keep us on track here, we'll be going over installation, startup, and operation of the world's first regenerable ion exchange system for PFAS removal. So we'll kind of whip through, you know, I know everyone here knows what PFAS is and all of that, and we'll briefly touch on kind of how it works with ion exchange, really just focusing on that regenerable process. A little bit of background on the site itself that we'll be talking about. You know, some troubleshooting, some great data to go over, and then walking through that full scale design implementation and lessons learned. And hopefully we'll have some time for questions too. So this project really started back in about 2014 due to the use of AFFF at the Pease Air Force Base out east in New Hampshire. You know, there was quite a bit of PFAS that eventually got into the drinking water system. A public advocacy group was formed and quite a bit of testing has done out there. And if you've followed the news recently, it's actually that group and some of the health testing that has been done as being continued to be done was brought up recently. So that's kind of where this really started, if you will. So it started as kind of a cleanup project, and you can see this former fire training area also affected some of the drinking water wells here on site. And then we'll even touch on just started up a drinking water system for the city of Portsmouth as well too. So how does it work quickly? You know, ion exchange, you're relying on adsorption just like carbon, but you also have that chemical attraction as well too. So the reaction's happening much faster. We're also able to, in this process, regenerate that resin, and I'll get into that a little bit more as well too. So you have that kind of dual mechanism, which results in higher capacities of the media itself, but then also a much faster reaction too. So it reduces the footprint of the overall process. So here's a little process flow, kind of what it looks like with the system. We have a picture as well too. So it's very similar to, if you're familiar with like a water softener process, right? So we have a regenerate solution, which is an alcohol and a brine solution as well too, to regenerate that media. And so collect the PFAS off the media that's been collected so that you can reuse it. And a big question I know that's asked is, are you retaining the capacity of the media? And what we've seen over the years so far is that we're able to maintain the capacity of the resin to hold onto that PFAS so far. So that's pretty promising. And then I have a treat too for everyone. So here's a little sample of our medias, if you will. And then the regenerable medias are here. So they're a kind of larger white, yellow to white color, a little more opaque than some of the single use resin that folks are using for drinking water. So the project originally started out with a pilot, and what was happening is basically the carbon was hitting breakthrough kind of within weeks. So it was determined that wasn't a super feasible option, but this was back in, you know, 2014, where other technologies, you know, hadn't really evolved yet. So that was really, you know, the only option that people had used so far for PFAS removal in these types of situations. So led to this pilot here, as you can see, where we kind of compared a couple different resins and granular activated carbon. So a little bit more background on the site, influent concentrations, PFOA and PFOS. So in the parts per billion, so a little bit higher concentration than, you know, typically talking in like the parts per trillion for drinking water. The goal here at this time was just to hit a 70 parts per trillion coming out of the system, though they are getting to non-detect, but we'll kind of check out that data a little bit later here. So initial results of the breakthrough of the piloting, and this, you know, was done at a 5-minute empty bed contact time, and that was really before resin was being used more commonly. And so a little bit higher contact time than maybe you'd see designed around now. But as you can see here, the volume treated or bed volumes at the bottom there for the sorbix, the blue line is the resin is much, much higher before you're hitting breakthrough through than the orange, which is the granular activated carbon. So a little bit more kind of on how that system works. Basically, you know, you can see the breakthrough on the resin is lasting much longer, but then you're also able to regenerate the resin. And we're doing that with that regenerate solution that I briefly mentioned. And then the next step too as well, we'll have some pictures, but this is kind of a nice graphic to show the distillation vessel. So we'll distill that regenerate solution and really super concentrate the PFAS, if you will. And then that is taken and it's loaded onto what we call a super loader media. And so that's just running at a very, very slow empty bed contact time. And that's where the PFAS is ultimately being collected and then will become the ultimate waste stream. So the other thing too, is this is kind of a precursor for destruction options. And actually at this particular site, the Pease Air Force Base, they are piloting a couple destructive technologies on the distillation bottoms, the still bottoms we call them. So here's what it looks like in real life. You can kind of see the vessels that will be regenerated when needed, but depending on breakthrough, you know, every site is a little bit different. And at this particular site, because it's a cleanup, we're getting lower and lower in concentration. You'll see that in a graphic soon. And so right now, looking at a treatment capacity of 200 gallons per minute is what this particular system can handle in the picture here. So this is what the distillation unit looks like. And the kind of off-white columns are that superloader media that I mentioned. So typically the goal will be 1,000,000 to 1 in terms of concentration of volume versus volume of waste that will ultimately need to be taken off site. And so this facility was put online in 2018 and they've not had to take any waste off site quite yet. And they've treated about 40 million gallons so far. And so here's kind of that nice data that I mentioned coming up. So you have higher concentrations and you can kind of see it tailoring off lower concentration that the cleanup efforts are working. And so hopefully we can take these forever chemicals completely, you know, off of this site and ultimately it can stop leaching out into nearby wells and groundwater. One big lesson learned, especially when it comes to utilizing different resins is they can be fairly sensitive to fouling. And this was so early on in the process, you know, we weren't as familiar with it back in, you know, 2015 or so. And so a big important part of piloting, right, is to figure out some of these things. And pretreatment was implemented to mitigate the iron fouling that we were seeing initially on site. And you can see that here in these lovely orange filter bags. So this ultimately ended up, you know, evolving into a drinking water project as well too, just because a couple of the wells have been affected. They did some piloting and, you know, compared GAC and resin again as well too on the drinking water. And you can see a similar effect where hitting breakthrough very quickly on the GAC, resin lasting a little bit longer. And then that's especially evident in the shorter chain PFAS compounds. So initially with the cleanup of the groundwater, you know, 70 was the goal for PFAS and PFOA, and the shorter chain compounds weren't as much of a concern. But when it came to the drinking water system, that was something that they wanted to start to look at and consider in their design. So the project was evaluated and designed by Weston & Sampson, and they did kind of a cost comparison on this particular facility. As you can kind of see the cost savings, and a lot of that is due to the savings in term of change out. So replacing the media less frequently, because for drinking water, it's a single pass. And then also just the footprint savings as well too. So keep us all on track and on time to wrap it up. Basically, you know, this is kind of one of the first applications of ion exchange, and then especially the regenerable system, and it can be a very effective treatment for PFAS. I think, you know, the big lesson learned is that pretreatment step and making sure we're not sending iron and other things to the resin itself so that we can maintain that really good capacity to remove PFAS. You know, this particular site, due to it being a couple years older than what we're talking about now, was looking really at 13 compounds. Currently, though, they're at complete non-detect. And that's, you know, one thing too with the regenerable system is you can drive that regeneration process depending on the limit. So you could regenerate it more frequently if, let's say, down the road, you know, there's a concern with a different compound that has emerged, because this is ever changing, right? You could just regenerate the system more frequently to kind of mitigate releasing that new compound into the environment. So, you know, as I kind of mentioned, the system's been operational for quite a few years now and been able to not have to take any waste offsite. Hopefully this is also kind of a precursor step for what we all ultimately want to do, which is complete mineralization of the molecule, right? And get rid of PFAS completely out of the environment. So, you know, that's really the ultimate goal here. And then, as I mentioned just recently now this spring, one of our first kind of large ion exchange resin systems for their drinking water plant was brought online as well too. So hopefully we have some questions. If not, I know we're kind of limited on time. You know, feel free to reach out if anyone has any specific questions or wants to bug me about anything. Happy to answer.
We do have time for a couple of questions.
Yeah, let's do it.
Anything yet, Lee?
Nothing yet.
Quiet group. That's what happens when you present after break.
Maybe I will ask one. I might have missed this, but how is the concentrated PFAS that comes off of the ion exchange dealt with now, currently?
Currently, at the full scale flow, it's loaded onto a super loader media, is what we call it. So it's basically just that smaller column of media. And since it's running on a much longer empty bed contact time, it's able to load on at a much higher concentration. And so that's what the kind of ultimate waste, if you will. Some other presentations I've done, which is nice, is a graphic where it's like 200 or so barrels to less than one barrel of waste is what they would look at if they're using a single-use carbon process. So, you know, we're still creating a waste stream. It's just much smaller. And then hopefully, you know, we'll go to that next step. So yeah, thanks for that question.